Just want to say welcome to the fourth in our series of webinars with Sesame Workshop. AP and Sesame Workshop have been in partnership since 2020, focused on addressing issues affecting young children's mental health. Today, the focus of our webinar is emotional distress in young children, and we're happy to have our presenters, Antonio Freitas from Sesame Workshop and Lynn Bufka from APA. Without further ado, I will turn over our presentation to them. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Efwa, and welcome everyone to today's conversation. Before we get started, we want to make sure that you begin with some of our furry friends. So I'm going to take the screen and share a quick video that we've recently launched as a PSA for all things connected to emotional health and well-being. Let's take a look together.
When he has a big feeling like being frustrated, humming a song can help you feel better. We all have big feelings, and we are all here for one another. Love your mind.
So friends, happy Thursday, and welcome to today's conversation with Sesame Workshop and the American Psychological Association on helping young children cope with emotional distress. In response to the growing mental health crisis, Sesame Workshop has launched a multi-year initiative to support the emotional well-being of young children and their families. And our latest resources support children experiencing emotional distress and the caring adults that help them through their lives. By focusing on nurturing relationships and the mind-body-heart connection, we help children develop a foundation for emotional well-being through engaging research-based content. And today, we're excited to share with you some of our newest resources and talk together through some of the ways to embed these playful assets into the work you're already doing to support children and their families. So for context, we'll ground today's conversation in the community joining us live, and it looks right now like there are over 400 people joining, and then define how distress shows up in families with young children. With a quick recap of Sesame Street content launches connected to emotional well-being, we'll then dive deeply into the videos, the articles, the storybooks, and those printable resources that you can share with clients in your care, and then close out with some Q&A featuring members of today's talk. But we can't get started until we take a look and celebrate all the members of the room, especially connected to today's speakers. And so with that, I want to pass the microphone over to Lynn to tell us a little bit about who you are, maybe your favorite Muppet, and most importantly, how you're feeling today.
Thank you, Antonio. I'm delighted to be here. I am Lynn Bufka. I'm a clinical psychologist licensed in the state of Maryland, but I've been working at APA for over 20 years now. My specialty is in the area of stress and anxiety. My clinical specialty is in that area, but that's not what I do full-time at APA. It's hard to pick a favorite Muppet. My mother would say Miss Piggy. She was always a big Miss Piggy fan. But after meeting Cookie Monster last year, he's the only one I know personally. So I'd have to say I particularly like Cookie Monster at this point. And he and I do share some fondness for cookies. So I'm excited to be here, and I'm really happy that the weather broke and it's not quite as hot as it has been in my neck of the woods.
Yes.
Thanks for having us and looking forward to our conversation.
Yes. Thanks so much, Dr. Bufka, for joining us, for sharing with us both who you are and how well connected you are to Sesame Street, and the only character from our Muppet family that has five fingers to hold on to those delicious cookies that not only he and you like, but I think probably a few more people in today's conversation. My name is Antonio Freitas, and as the Senior Director of Educational Experiences on the U.S. Social Impact side of Sesame Workshop, my job is to work throughout the course of the day building out a lot of our trauma-informed content and the ways that we communicate those assets to grown-ups working with children and families through things like online courses, in-person presentations, and webcasts like this. And then at night, I'm an adjunct professor working with early childhood teachers, preparing them for classrooms and children and families that join those places. faces. My favorite Muppet is Bert. I've told some friends that I have a twin brother, and so as we were growing up, we were playfully referred to as Bert and Ernie, and that has continued to stay as I've grown. And I'm feeling really excited today to see both so many people in the conversation and to have you here, Dr. Bufka, to really guide all of the work we're doing and to sort of give a little bit of the behind-the-scenes backstory on how we helped create these assets. So that's a little bit about the two of us, friends, but I'd love for you that are in the audience right now to take a quick minute and in the chat window, let us know how you're feeling today. The world's a crazy place and there's a lot of things that are on lots of our minds. And so we want to create some time and opportunity to just sit in those feelings with each other. So let us know in the chat window how you're doing today. We have friends here from Australia, from Illinois, people that are excited, enthusiastic, inspired, optimistic, people from Puerto Rico, people feeling peaceful. So all over the place, feeling all the different feelings, which is dynamite. And friends, as you continue to draft this information in the chat, when we want to keep celebrating these things, but also flag that the Muppet that got all of this started was a little red friend named Elmo, and he asked this question sort of generally online and got a heartfelt response. Let's take a quick minute, and then as you take a look and share out these answers, we'll share with you the world's response to Elmo's question.
Elmo could not find anybody who feels sad.
But he did. Elmo learned an important lesson this week. I guess be careful what you wish for. Everyone's favorite furry red monster posted a simple question on X on Monday, quote, how's everyone doing? Here's what happened.
People decided to unload their very real problems onto poor Elmo, posts ranging from I'm depressed and broke to the world is burning around us, Elmo. Just a day after the Lions playoff loss, the Detroit Free Press weighing in with Elmo saying, quote, we've been better. Actress Rachel Zegler writing, resisting the urge to tell Elmo that I'm kind of sad.
It's not all jokes. So Elmo's question and the avalanche of responses really underscore the worsening mental health crisis in this country. A Gallup report from last year found 1 in 6 adults in the U.S. say they're depressed and receiving treatment for that depression. That is a 7% increase from 2015.
But while Elmo may have unexpectedly sparked a thread of gloom and doom, it wasn't all bad. Some of his best friends, well, they stepped up in a big way. Ernie telling Elmo, quote, if you ever need some cheering up, let me know. I love making others smile. Bert saying, quote, I'm here if you ever need a shoulder to lean on, adding he will make a warm cup of tea for both of them. Abby Cadabby told Elmo to stop by her garden if he ever needs a reminder of how magical he is. And if he ever needs to talk, Cookie Monster, he'll be there to supply the cookies.
Hey, even President Biden weighed in, telling Elmo, quote, even though it's hard, you're never alone. Elmo responded to the overwhelming popularity of his initial post, saying he was glad he asked that question. And he, quote, learned that it is important to ask a friend how they are doing before saying he will check in again soon. He also added a message that Sesame Street fans know all too well.
Most of all, yes, most of all, Elmo loves you.
So friends, we know that with just that gentle, innocuous question, Sesame Street and our fans and the Muppets that make us a family generated over 175 million different comments of just people sharing their emotional response to the world around them and how they're processing things. And while all of those people and all of those feelings are valid and important, today's conversation is principally founded on the ways that we can support little children with big feelings. And so to ground us in this context, I wanted to give space for Lynn to share with us a little bit more about what it means for children when they experience emotional distress. Can you share with us, Dr. Bufka, what this looks like in the context of children and what sort of things both providers and caregivers need to be aware of in this context?
Yeah, there's so much to think about in this space. It's important to realize that for young children, their emotions are often really big, no matter what's going on. And because they are still very new in the world and much of what they encounter is new, it can be exciting or frustrating or scary or sad, but kind of all emotions with a big exclamation point on it. We don't expect children to know how to manage their emotions. That's the adult job, to help them to learn to identify and name emotions and then figure out what to do with them. And that can be hard for us as adults because we don't necessarily want the big emotions spilling everywhere. But while it's hard for us as the ones who love the young children, if young children are having the hardest time holding it together when they're with us, but they can hold it together elsewhere, that's a good thing. That means they feel safest to release their big feelings with us. But what can it look like? It might look like aggression or maybe trouble paying attention. They might have some anxiety with separating from their caregivers. You might see temper tantrums. They might talk about physical complaints, like their stomach hurts. And they're not going to be at a place to be able to say, "Hey, mom, hey, teacher, here's what's happening. This is how I describe it the way that you all can do in the chat." So that's really important to realize that they may not have an easy way to say it.
I love and appreciate the fact that you talked about this idea of having all of the emotions with all of the exclamation, and how what I hear you saying is also the role of a parent and a caring grown-up in those spaces is to not only observe those, but to help a child manage in healthy ways what to do about having that emotion. And so, with that as a framing context for this dialogue, we want to share with you a little bit more about not only the resources that we've had and will launch today, but those that have come before that are all in trust to supporting children and families through big feelings. And so, for context, in May of 2023, we established a foundation for our well-being work with a focus on building relationships. And this was done through nurturing, trusting, caring connections that strengthen resilience, a sense of safety, and overall well-being. Resources from this first phase are foundational and preventative and include a storybook that's like My Grown-Up Cares, the song and the video that match me and my grown-up, the feelings garden and the matching printable, and an article called Tuning In. In the second wave and launch this past November, we built upon that foundation of the first bucket with resources that went a little bit deeper, introducing new actionable strategies reflected in the resources like the interactive game I Notice, I Feel, and I Can, the video Butterfly Breathing with Abby Kadabi, and the storybook Feelings, Feelings Everywhere. And this really goes back to the point that Lynn was addressing about how we as adults around children can help expand emotional literacy by having not only the words help children understand what they're feeling, but also how to help them process those. And so across this second wave, we really aimed at nurturing children's well-being by giving enriching emotional literacy, particularly around difficult emotions. And now, today, we're addressing and responding to the mental health challenges, making new information accessible for providers. This includes identifying and providing resources with concrete support to address problems in thinking, feeling, and in the context of relationships. And before we dive into them, though, we wanted to take a moment to acknowledge both the APA and all of you, its members, for helping to guide this work in thoughtful moments. And for that, we have a video with Sophia, Sesame Street's very own feelings helper, who, like all of you, play a vital role in building smarter, stronger, kinder communities, one relationship at a time. Let's celebrate all of you with a quick video.
Oh, this is awesome!
Oh, look at these bunnies!
Oh, those are so cute! Oh, a dancer! Oh!
Nurse Elmo is ready to help!
Firefighter Carly, reporting for duty.
Because we're
special helpers.
Hi, Elmo. Hey, Carly.
Oh, hi, Sophia.
Hi. Oh, nice costumes. What are you playing?
Oh, Elmo and I are playing dress up. Today we're dressing up as special helpers.
Yeah, that's right. Elmo is a nurse who helps keep people's bodies healthy.
Yeah, and I'm a firefighter. I help keep people safe from fires.
Oh, well, that's amazing. Can I play? You know, I'm a special helper too.
Sophia is really cool. But, where's your costume?
This is my costume.
Oh.
This is what I wear when I do my job. Ah. I am a therapist, a counselor. I'm a feelings helper.
Oh, a feelings helper?
That's right. Everyone has big feelings sometimes. But a feelings helper can help when children's big feelings get too big.
Oh. You know, Elmo's daddy helps him with his big feelings. Like if Elmo's feeling sad, Elmo's daddy gives him a great big hug.
Oh, that's wonderful, Elmo. You know, you can always talk to a caring grown-up. And sometimes people need a little extra help, too.
Oh, that's when a feelings helper can really help.
That's right. When our big feelings keep us from doing things that we really want to do, like learning or sleeping.
Yeah, and playing.
Oh, and having fun?
Mm-hmm. When big feelings get so big, it can really help to talk to a therapist or counselor and spend time doing therapy and counseling together.
Yeah, my mom and I both have our own feelings helpers, and sometimes we go to therapy together.
Oh, yeah, lots of kids and grown-ups go.
Oh, well, what happens in therapy?
Oh, when I go to therapy, I talk about my feelings and things that I can do to help me feel better.
Oh. Mm-hmm. We listen, draw, play, practice our deep breathing. And lots of other things.
Wow. Being a feelings helper sounds like a really important job.
Oh, it really is.
Hey, since we're all in our special helper's costumes, let's play!
Yeah! Nurse Elmo will use his stethoscope to listen to people's hearts.
Oh, and I'll use my hose to put out fires.
Yeah!
Oh, and I will use my ears to listen, my eyes to notice, and my mouth to talk.
Cool. Hey, Elmo knows something else he can use to help people.
What's that, Elmo?
Elmo can use his arms to hug.
Oh, get in here, Sophia. Ah, it's a nice hug.
So while we recognize and deliberately created that video for all children, whether or not they're seeing a therapist or counselor, we know that children like Elmo and Carly can begin to understand the jobs of feelings helpers, those professionals who help children and grownups too with big feelings, by having some sort of parallel play or connection, which is why we wanted to be very deliberate about having them dressed up as feelings helpers as well, to really sort of build that bridge between Sophia and her Muppet friends. We know that emotions like anger and sadness and fear are natural and unavoidable, and that they may be challenging for children and adults alike. But all feelings are there for a reason. All feelings are important, and learning to cope with the difficult ones well, rather than just make them go away, is really the real goal that we see a video like this can help share about the great work that you and everyone at APA is doing with children and families. So after watching, you might talk about helpers in general with children and families in your care. You know, some helpers, like those doctors and nurses that Carly and Elmo were playing, help our bodies healthy, stay healthy. Feelings helpers help keep our minds healthy. And other types of helpers, like firefighters and crossing guards, keep us safe too. But you can talk about the many other helpers in a family's life and the life of a broader community. And even in that space, giving children a chance to remind them that they are kinds of helpers too, and that lots of adults and kids see feelings helpers. It's just a brave thing to do. We've been able to continue on with the story of Sophia and the context of feelings helpers with a storybook. And this is, again, one that really starts to flag some of the different ways that feelings helpers are seen and recognized throughout the community. We're going to take a look through the first few pages of this book, and I'd love to both get a sense from you, Lynn, and also from the friends in the chat window about what you think about this book and how you might introduce this to children or families in your care after I share the first few pages. Let's take a look together.
Thanks, feelings helpers. The friends were making cards. This one's for Elmo's doctor and nurse, said Elmo. This one is for the firefighters at the firehouse, said Carly. This one is for my teacher, Rosita said. Hi, Sophia said. Pretty cards. They're for our helpers, Rosita explained. Sophia smiled. How kind of you. You know, I got a helper card today, too. Really? Elmo asked. What kind of helper are you? Well, said Sophia, I'm a special kind of helper called a feelings helper. What's that? Rosita asked. Feelings helpers are caring grown-ups who help kids when their feelings, like angry, sad, worried, and more, are really big, Sophia explained. Oh, Elmo has big feelings sometimes, Elmo said. Like, sometimes Elmo feels sad and cries when Elmo's daddy drops Elmo off at school because Elmo misses Daddy. Sophia nodded. We all have big feelings. It's okay to feel angry, sad, or scared. And all feelings are important. But sometimes our big feelings get so big that it makes it hard to do the things we want to do, like play, make friends, learn, sleep, try new things, and just have fun. That's when a feelings helper can help. Lots of kids go to feelings helpers. Feelings helpers are called therapists or counselors, and the time you spend with them is called therapy. Sometimes the whole family goes to a feelings helper together. That helps everyone in the family. In therapy, sometimes you might play with toys or games, or draw your feelings. That can help you understand how to take care of them and figure out ways to feel better. Feelings helpers listen closely to understand what you're thinking and feeling. We all need different kinds of help at different times. We can get through hard times together by asking for help when we need it. Many grown-ups go to feelings helpers by themselves, too. We can all learn how to take care of ourselves and our feelings. Wow, I didn't know that was your job, Carly said. I've gone to a feelings helper, and my mom goes to her own feelings helper, too. Rosita said. My abuela says I'm a good listener and a caring friend. Maybe I'll be a feelings helper when I grow up. You'd be a great feelings helper, Rosita, Sophia said. Okay, let me practice, Rosita said. How are you all feeling today? Well, Elmo feels excited to give his doctor and nurse this card, Elmo said. I'm feeling happy about the art I made, Carly added. And I feel proud of all of you, Sophia smiled. Thanks, feelings helpers.
So a very sweet book. And just a few things to note before I pass the microphone over to you, Lynn, interested to hear your thoughts. But, you know, we tried to really fuse in a wink to the previous initiatives by putting in those emotional literacy words and also giving definitions and real concrete language and names to the different feelings helpers across all of our communities. And to the point that many friends in the chat window flagged, just making sure that it was something that was normalized to reduce stigma, shame, embarrassment, or fear about talking about all of the brave ways that children and families become clients of feelings helpers like all of you. So interested to hear your thoughts, what struck out to you for that, or what things you're sort of still sitting with.
I mean, this is such a lovely book. It's a great way to explain to kids when you might want to be introducing them to the idea that they're going to go see a feelings helper, or to introduce to other children in the family that their sibling might be going to see a feelings helper, or to even just introduce this as a possibility. But I actually really love the other part that you were talking about, Antonia, where lots of the words that we'd like for children and families to be comfortable with are talked about in the book. Right. And so talk about what big feelings are. So it also gives parents and teachers and daycare providers and everybody who's working with young children maybe some new ways of expressing these ideas that are more kid friendly and parent friendly. It's easy for professionals to talk in a very professional way about how we have to process our emotions, and big emotions or those feelings really are indicative of blah, 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 right? But that doesn't get at what kids talk, how kids talk, and how parents who are very worried about their children might talk about it. So it provides both. I see it as so many possible ways It's a great story that helps children feel good about themselves. It helps explain something that many people don't understand, adults included. And it provides that language that can be useful for any family to talk about big feelings.
Great. And connected to that, and with regard to some of the questions and reflections in the chat window, this book is available for free in English and in Spanish, as well as all the different assets that we're going to be showcasing today and those that are on sesameworkshop.org. Right now, we have not yet dipped our toes into the waters of ASL, but that's something that we're very excited about and are starting to do some research on. For those friends in the chat window that named that this would be a great book to extend to larger, older students, while, you know, our sweet spot is really birth to eight and specifically 2 to 6. You know, whenever I have these conversations with providers and other caregivers, what I tend to do is say, you know, after third grade, kids love Elmo, but they're not as excited about Elmo as maybe a 3, a 4-year-old. And so what you can do and what I've done in the past have taken the book and the concepts from the book and say, how would you age this up? If it is a task for a middle schooler, you might say, what would you do if you had to write this book for an older student, to get them to think a little bit more about the behind-the-scenes context and how they could age it up for a different group. It doesn't always get the work done, but it starts to sort of begin the process of thinking about what are the words we use to start to destigmatize what this looks like as people age and grow into that context. So friends, we're going to keep going on. And in addition to that video and that storybook connected to Feelings Helpers, we have a few Muppet moments that children and their grownups can both laugh with and learn from. We know that moments can be transformed with the help of some simple household objects. In the video on the left of your screen that we call the ocean bottle, Abby Kadabi demonstrates an easy way to use our senses to discover the power of mindfulness. And so I want to take a minute to both show everyone what the video is and then show you how easy this could be to communicate and share with children and families in your care.
And a 1, and a 2, and a 3, and a 4, and a 5, and a 6, and a 7,
and a 8.
Hi, Jelly. Hi, Abby.
Well, that looks like some really good exercise.
Oh, yeah. It sure is, Abby, because it's my shaky, take-a-breaky workout. Moving my body around helps me feel real good.
Oh, that's what my ocean bottle does for me. Yep. It's something I can use to help calm my body when I'm having a big feeling.
Wow, is that what that pretty blue thing is right there?
Yep. Oh, it's great for when I'm feeling nervous or excited or even if I'm feeling angry. Because, well, sometimes those big feelings make me feel like this. Watch. The waves are rough and they're swirling around. But when the waves settle down a little bit, like this, I take a few deep breaths. Watch. Here, calm now. Then my big feelings don't feel as big anymore. They're smaller, like these little gentle waves. And watching the water helps my body feel calmer and relaxed.
That is amazing, Abby.
Yeah, it sure is, right?
Yeah.
Hey, do you want to try it?
But Abby, I'm not having any big feelings right now.
Well, that's okay, Telly. You know, you can practice using it for when you are having big feelings. Here.
Ooh, The water inside is nice and cool. I love how heavy the bottle feels in my hands.
Yeah. Oh, my favorite part is watching the waves move back and forth because they make such a relaxing sound. Listen.
Yeah. Wow. I really love this bottle, Abby. Where'd you get it?
I made it.
You made this? How?
My mommy helped me. It's mostly water in a clear bottle, and you add a few drops of blue food coloring and some vegetable oil, and ta-da! You've got yourself a handy-dandy ocean bottle.
Wow. It's pretty simple. I'm gonna make one when I get home. But can I keep practicing with this one for now?
Of course you can, Telly. And in the meantime, I'm going to try the flaky, reiky, wakey, snakey workouts.
You mean the shaky, shaky, take a breaky
workout. Yeah.
Close enough, Abby.
This is fun. It feels great. I'm glad we have things to help us with our big feelings, Telly.
Me too, Abby. Me too.
So sweet little video. And in addition to not only that video, but some of the information from it, we have on the next slide that I'll show you a very easy way to make this jar with either glitter glue and water and some olive oil at home, or with just some blue food coloring. And I will say we had an event at Sesame Workshop a few years ago. I was with a few children and I made one just because I happened to be in the space with them. And I put it by my desk. And every time I happen to be in the middle of a meeting or trying to process something, I look down and will inevitably have it in my hand, just turning it back and forth. And so it becomes a touchstone, not only for the children in our care, but can be just as easily used for all of us when we have big feelings or try to process our own information. For those friends in the chat window that were asking questions, a few things. Yes, this video is available for free on YouTube and also on sesameworkshop.com. It is available in multiple languages, and I'm going to show you how to get to those in a moment. But I thought that before I would give Dr. Bufka a chance to share with us, you know, you talked about Cookie Monster being your favorite. I know that the Count is also a fan. And so we know that with this video that we all created, we made a couple more featuring the Count because we wanted to seize upon the opportunity of using some counting moments that children could do connected to their own body for self-regulation. And it includes the video Count on This, where a child could count on three things they look forward to in times of need or stress. Count on This, a 6-second hug, just to have physical connection with someone or something else to, again, self-regulate. Or again, a 10-second hum, just to get children to vibrate and reconnect with their own bodies through a song or a sound that is comfortable to them. So, given all three of those options, which one would you like to watch together?
Oh, goodness, there's so many good ones, but I would really like to do this 10-second hum.
The 10-second hum. So let's take a look online and show people not only how to get to these videos, but all of the resources available. I'm going to go to sesame.org. And when I go to sesame.org, I'll just start from the top so that everyone can see it. You're welcome to a page that gives you a sense with Elmo and friends on a school bus on what our work is all about, principally mission-driven and child-focused. On the top, under family resources, you have three large buckets that highlight the wealth of different topics that we reach children and families through. That includes ABCs and 1-2-3s, and that is any resource or topic specific to school readiness, things like science, art, financial education, language and literacy. The next big broad topic is called Healthy Minds and Bodies. And that includes things like asthma, autism, eating well, and what we're talking about today, emotional well-being. And then our third bucket is called Tough Topics. And those are principally about topics that are not necessarily what children have key roles in, but they're sadly having to react to or having to address in real time through no fault of their own. This includes things like incarceration, homelessness, grief, death, parental addiction, and traumatic experiences. And so while we have topics and resources that address all of these different things across all of these different buckets, for today's conversation, we're going to go into healthy minds and bodies and down to emotional well-being. And when I click on emotional well-being, just like all of the other pages, you'll have a quick title that reminds you of what the page is all about. 1 to 2 sentences that are adult-facing that give you a sense of what the rest of the resources will look like. And then as you continue to scroll down, a breakdown of those resources. There was that Love Your Mind video that we started to kick off today's conversation. And then the newest resources that we have reflected here. And just with the click of an arrow, you can see all of the different ones on a carousel that you can easily click into for free that are available in English and in Spanish. Now, since Lynn said that she wanted to take a look at the 10-second hug, I'm going to click on Count on This, the 10-second hug. You get a chance to see that screen grab of what the Count's picture is all about. A reminder that it's a video, the title of the video, and then the page it's on, the intended age of the child or the family it's for. This is a preschooler, ages 3 to 5, a kindergartner, ages 5 to 6, or a big kid, ages 7 and up. And then a quick sentence that lets you know what the article, the video, or the asset is all about. This one says humming for 10 seconds or more can help both children and adults calm their minds. Let's take a look together.
Do you ever feel worried or nervous? Well, when I feel worried, I hum. That's right. Humming a song for 10 seconds or more can calm your mind and body. You can hum Happy Birthday, the Transylvania Two-Step, Twinkle Twinkle, or my favorite, One Potato. Come on, hum along with me. Ah, I feel calmer. This is one. One calm count, one count. Ah, ah, ah.
Oh, that's nice.
How do you feel, little potato?
Well, I actually feel great. Yeah, that song really speaks to me.
Then let us hum it again.
Okay. Very nice.
Thank you.
I appreciate both the video and the fact that it's practiced twice, but the potato is also a nice little extra button in it. And friends, if you're not quite sure what to do before, during, or after the use of that video with children or families in your care, we've also been able to script a recommendation of how you might implement this or what this could look like in your context. And what we have found is that often people are a little apprehensive about the best ways to start, but after doing this just once or twice, it gets real easy, and then you begin to fold it in a way that is most meaningful to you. So again, use this as a jumping off point and then make it work for you in whatever way feels most accessible. So we're moving on now to the second type of asset we're going to be, sorry, the third type of asset we're going to be exploring today, and those are printable. These are easily printed documents that can be used and available in English and in Spanish to share with both children and the adults in their family. These range from coloring papers to research directories to even planning documents that adults might use with children in their care. We know that in this context, kids can soothe themselves with homemade comfort containers like you saw Telly and Abby make in that previous video. And so to that end, in the middle of your page, you have a printable that says helping children soothe themselves. And it includes not only the ingredients, but the step-by-step easy directions to make that jar of the Feelings Ocean bottle so that children can see and experiencing it in real time. In addition to that, we also have just below it the document called Taking Care of My Brain that helps give children a sense of seeing all the different ways they can benefit from movement, nutrition, and rest that come from healthy minds and bodies. And then you and the team at APA really helped us with both the two articles on the outer sides of that slide that say reaching out and finding mental health resources for children and families. While one is intended specifically for providers working with children and families, the second is a document that you as APA members can share with children and families in your care as they continue to find other ways and resources to help guide the work that you have started with all of them. In this context, what we're looking for is just continued crowd brilliance from not only you, Lynn, but all of the friends in today's conversation. And so we'd love to take a moment at this time to invite people to use the chat window and to share with us strategies that they've been able to communicate to clients in their care about how to help children soothe themselves. And Lynn, I'd love to hear from you as we're waiting to see people chime in their answers. What have you been able to do with success?
You know, I think one of the things that has been so helpful, especially kind of for everybody, but blowing bubbles can be really a great way. So maybe kids aren't comfortable with the idea of just slowing their breathing, but blowing bubbles helps them change how they're breathing, which can help settle down their physiology when it gets all revved up, right? So using bubbles to blow bubbles can be a great way to do that. And as kids get more adept at it, you can help spread it out, right? Blow it for a long time and help them change their breathing that way. So bubbles are a wonderful tool.
I love the interpretation of how that can be so flexibly and creatively designed, right? In that same way, I'm seeing friends in the chat want to put different types of hug. I saw a butterfly hug, an elephant hug, a dragon breathing, some great different resources that friends are sharing about different ways they can continue to help children relax and sort of contain the spillover that comes from those big feelings. When we talk about different resources for grown-ups in a children's care, we often use articles as that jumping-off point that Sesame Street resources can use to begin dialogue between children and the adults in their lives that are working with children. And in the most recent article that we've launched for our emotional distress page, we are trying to really focus on ways that parents and caregivers can react and respond in healthy ways when they are concerned about a child's health and well-being. And, you know, while I did not highlight all of the different language and copy from the article, I just tried to take the big ideas. I know we only have 1 hour together, so I'm just trying to make sure that I get the big hits. And in this article, what we really try to highlight is the bulleted points that are on this screen, that it's important to connect with others, both in person and online, to talk to your child's health provider, to share with families so they can talk to trusted friends and family, and to check in with children about their lives, and to just keep on noticing. We know that there are a wealth of other suggestions and guidance points, Lynn, but I'd love to hear from you in your perspective and experience. Do any of these trump the others? Is there a priority when it comes to thinking about which one of these to do first or quickest?
Yeah, I think there's a couple of things. Depends on who you are, right? If you're the parent or the caregiver, what you're going to do. But if you're the parent, it's helpful for you to talk to other trusted people and get some support, because you may be particularly worried about your kid and you really need to have somebody who can help you think about what's going on, or even just give you a break for 15 minutes or half an hour so you can have a little bit of time away or see how your child's interacting with somebody else. So really talking to trusted friends and family, I think it's great for parents. And certainly for caregivers, your first stop is going to be talking to the parents so they can know what you're seeing in the child's life. But really after that, I think all of these are wonderful things to be doing. And the more present that different adults can be in young children's lives, the better, right? It really does take a village, and remembering that you're part of that village can be really helpful to kids, because they can learn different things from people who aren't their parents. Mm-hmm. And that's an important place to be.
I love the sort of the expansion of that circle of care around a child, right? That I'm thinking of the Bronfenbrenner ecological model, right? And sort of thinking about all the different grownups that play a pivotal role. And when we are talking to each other about the same child, you see a whole lot more and can paint with a lot more colors of the rainbow to figure out what a child needs, wants, and is being successful at. So thank you for naming that and really sort of articulating that for all of us. And in that same sense, right, when we think of other providers supporting children, their families, and the caregivers connected to them, we also try to thread in those people in educational contexts. And we know that when little kids have big feelings, caring adults need to move in fast. That, to Lynn's point, changes in social behavior, eating habits, and even extended bouts of both of sadness can compromise our ability to build smarter, stronger, kinder communities one child at a time. But the good thing is that there are things that we can do to help the youngest learners in our lives bounce back from challenges with joy, engagement, and drive. And so in the webcast that's reflected on your screen, we had a conversation with Erica Key, the founder and chief learning officer of Learning Seeds, who helped guide us in an in-depth conversation about exploring strategies that early child care professionals can use to support children engaged in emotional challenges. And what she sort of says in the context of educational contexts and early learning spaces is that there's three sort of guiding things to consider. This idea of exploration, that when children are in a room and they can move about it, we want to encourage them to spend time thinking with the materials and activities to extend and to showcase what they're feeling on the inside to the outside world. That second piece is interaction, that we know that children begin receiving and responding to information about rules and body language and facial instructions and expressions and conversations with their peers when they are engaged with everyone. And so to Lynn's earlier point, the more that we can engage everyone in the neighborhood about a child's health and a family's well-being, the better we all are for that. And then finally, with regards to a third context of imagination, Erica Key highlights in this webcast this importance of making sure that children begin understanding, asking about, and adding to ideas of a group so that they can recognize that they are contributing to something that is larger than themselves. And so, while again, this webcast is intended for people in early care and educational settings, I'm just flagging it for you all as an extra slide here, because there are some key strategies that I think work in any setting or any conversation with children and their families. So we've talked through a lot of different assets and watched a lot of fun videos, but we always like to do a few more animations to help both gamify hard topics, but also give children something to say yes to. And in the first wave of our assets, the three videos that we focused on really sort of showcase the ways that children can care for their brain. This included Caring for Your Brain, Twiddle Bugs Get Moving, about our smallest friends on a playground, those little bugs that work with each other to learn about how to keep their brain healthy through movement. And then also Caring for My Brain, A Bedtime Meltdown, showcasing in an animation with Abby, her little brother, and her dad, ways that everyone can get ready for bed, and sometimes the challenges connected to that. And then finally, with all of our favorite Muppets, or at least mine, with Bert and Ernie, Caring for My Brain, Brain Food has to really highlight how we can eat a rainbow of fruits and vegetables to keep us healthy in between those different busy times of the day that have us moving and grooving. But in addition to those, we've also added a few more fun ones. And these five animations that are currently showcased on your slide really, in our effort, are trying to share some of the different ways that we can use the world around ourselves and our children to help manage challenging times. In Comfort Container, that one with Big Bird and Granny Bird, when Big Bird feels overwhelmed, he uses his comfort container to calm his feelings. In A Good Friend to Myself, Rosita knows that it's important to be a good friend to herself as well as others, and this video really helps to teach children how to be compassionate, first to themselves and then to those around them. In A Gratitude Jar, we want to showcase this idea that a gratitude jar can help us pause, notice, and savor the feelings that good things in our lives can bring. And in Helped, Heard, or Hugged, we wanted to showcase that when kids are upset, asking what they need can help them feel validated. And then finally, Teaching My Brain showcases the ways that we can train our brains with positive self-talk. And so, friends, we only have a few minutes on today's call, but I did want to give you all the space to, using a quick poll that we'll launch right now, share with us which video you would like to watch together. Is it A Comfort Container, A Good Friend to Myself, Gratitude Jar, Helped, Heard, or Hugged, or Teaching My Brain? Take a quick moment, and then we'll go online and take a look at them together. Let's keep the poll up for maybe 10 more seconds. All right, let's see what we're thinking. Teaching My Brain looks to be the winner. Thank you so much. Let's take a look, and I'm going to just show you once more online how to access these resources and so many more. I'm going to go to sesame.org, and when I go there, I'll take a look under Family Resources, and because today we're talking about emotional well-being, I'm going to go under Healthy Minds and Bodies. I'll scroll down to Emotional Well-being, and as I continue to go down the page, you'll see all of the different assets that we've recently made. And if you can't find the ones that we were talking about, that's okay. You can continue to scroll down and to see even more. They're available in English and in Spanish, and all of the resources are reflected in a comprehensive list below. But if you're short on time or not quite sure what you were looking for, you can also filter. And you can filter by age group, that is toddlers, 1 to 3, and I'm apologizing if it's pretty, so I can make it bigger. Toddlers, preschoolers, kindergartners, big kids, or grownups. The languages that we have available. And again, right now, all of our assets are available in English and Spanish. Some are available on different topics in different pages. The different resource types, including videos, articles, printables, storybooks, games, webinars, and podcasts. And then also the length of time you or a person you're sharing this might have with a child, either under 5 minutes or more than 20 or somewhere in between. We said here that I believe Teaching My Brain was what we would be watching. So let's take a look at it together. I'm going to click on that. And just like before, it showcases what the asset is, the title of the asset, the intended topic and group you can use it for, a quick sentence about what the topic is all about, language underneath that says what you can do with it, and then the asset itself.
Elmo, are you ready, son? We need to get to school on time.
Coming, Daddy! Elmo is ready for school now.
Is your jacket all zipped up?
Oh, well, Elmo is almost ready.
All right.
Once we get you zipped up, we'll head out to school. Oh, better not forget my keys. Hey, my keys aren't on the key holder? Uh-oh, I made a mistake. I put my keys somewhere they don't belong. All right, Louie, think. Let's remember what you did. You came in from work last night. You stopped to take off your jacket.
Then you gave Elmo a hug.
Oh, that's right. Next, Louie, you walked to the sofa and you sat down. Louie, I know you can do this.
Yeah, Elmo thinks you can do it too, Daddy.
Thanks, son. I'll find those keys. Louie, you always find what you're looking for.
Daddy, why do you keep calling yourself Louie?
Well, I use my name to encourage myself not to give up. We can all speak kindly to ourselves.
Oh, just like the way that we speak to someone we love?
That's right. Oh, hold on, Louie. You picked out a book last night. Oh, Louie, you did it.
Yeah.
Now, let's get you zipped up so we can get you to school.
Daddy, Elmo can do it. Elmo? Elmo can do this. Elmo is a little monster that never gives up. Oh, Elmo's got the first part in. Now just pull, Elmo. Yay! Elmo did it!
Great job, son.
Oh, we better go, Daddy.
I'm with you.
Yay! Elmo can't wait for school.
So in addition to some of the comments made in the chat window, animation really is comforting to watch. I don't know if that's just a me thing or an us thing, but I know that it's something that feels relaxing and calls to mind some of the more joyful moments of our childhood. But we really wanted to aim in both this animation and in the others on that slide, the importance of not only modeling for children how adults can get through these things, but also that that adults still have to deal with these issues too. That as children grow up, that doesn't mean big feelings don't go away. That just means we have more and more tools to model how to best address them in healthy ways that can still quell a situation. And so in this video and others, there's a few fun ones of Elmo's dad, Louie, and other adults needing those gentle reminders that a child can both model back to them or remind adults of the ways that it was modeled to them.
Us grown-ups on Sesame Street.
So friends, we're beginning to wind down today's talk, but before we do, in the same way that we started with everybody, we want to take one quick moment to again acknowledge all of the great work that is being done in this room and because of the people in this room.
All of us grown-ups on Sesame Street really care about children's emotional well-being.
Oh, and monsters too.
We want children and monsters to grow healthy and strong in every way, in mind, body, and heart.
Yeah. All you feelings helpers are so important.
Yeah. Kids and families and monsters appreciate you.
Yeah. Thank you to all the teachers.
And the counselors and the social workers.
And all the therapists, psychologists, child life specialists, faith leaders, psychiatrists, and all the caring grown-ups who help children and their families with their big feelings.
From all of your friends on Sesame Street.
Thank you.
And as a quick recap, y'all, we've been able over this last hour to talk about the three big waves of emotional well-being resources that the Sesame Workshop has been able to successfully create because of the guidance of Dr. Bufka and so many of the other friends at APA. Most recently, we are addressing and responding to mental health challenges and making new information available for providers like you with things like storybooks, articles, videos, those calming animations, and printable resources that show us step by step how to make those ocean bottles and quell crazy seas for children and families in our care. All of these resources live on sesame.org, where you can get them for free in English and in Spanish, or just by accessing the QR code that's in the upper right-hand corner of your screen. And in addition to those resources, there's three other supplemental topic pages that speak a little bit more generally to the things that children might be feeling as they continue to grow and the ways that caring adults can address these in healthy ways. On our social emotional skills page, we can help kids develop skills for healthy relationships, to the ability to respect differences, and to build the social behaviors and confidence that they need. We can also give children tools and coping skills to overcome both little and big challenges to them through the resource page, Building Resilience in Children and in Families. And finally, we can think about ways to explore and encourage connection through quality time and play within families through our topic page on family bonding. And these pages, along with our emotional well-being, as well as so many others that were asked in our chat window, can be reflected in sesame.org when you click under Family Resources into one of those three big categories: ABCs and 1-2-3s, Healthy Minds and Bodies, and Tough Topics. While all of the different topics live there and can be easily accessed just by scrolling down and clicking into them, you can also, if you're unsure of the name of a topic, or even if we have a topic about something that you're looking for, just click into the magnifying glass on the upper right-hand corner and write a word that will auto-populate to the rest of it. For instance, today we're talking about feelings helpers. And so if I write feelings, all of the different assets that we have using that word will pop up. And so it's a great tool to use if you're unsure of what we have or what you're looking for. So friends, we've talked a whole lot today. I've talked a whole lot. Lynn shared a whole lot more. We wanted to sort of start to close out today's conversation by thinking a little bit more about what has stuck out to you. So take a moment to reflect on those points made today during today's talk and consider those that you're taking with you beyond the webcast into your work with children, with families, and with other providers across your network. And then when I say go, not yet, but when I say go, share in the chat window what is still sticking with you. I'll give you a quiet minute to think about it. All right, go. These are coming in fast. We got the ocean bottle, that mental health and understanding is essential, that feelings doctor is great, and that we can address feelings from a place of understanding and compassion. Dr. Bufka, what's jumping out to you?
I just think the comments in the chat are amazing. They're blowing by so fast, I can't keep up with all of them. But I just love how we can use all of this, not only for kids that we can see are in distress, but for all of us, so that all of us can be healthier. Everybody in the population can be healthier and have better overall well-being and really thrive in the places that they live and grow and go to school.
Yeah, definitely. Friends, as we start to close out today's conversation, I know a few people have been able to throw things into the chat window. I'm gonna take a look right now and see if we can answer any of them in real time. Ooh, so just taking a look at some of the quick ones. What is Sesame Street's take on the use of social media on children's health? So this is a two-pronged answer. One is we know that the internet is a scary place and that it is a place made for adults. And so we really are trying to think about, through partnerships with organizations that are doing similar work, ways we can provide the best information in appropriate ways to children and families to make decisions for themselves. And in addition to all of the great emotional well-being resources we've been able to reflect here, we are beginning to engage on supplemental resources connected to what we do in digital spaces connected to emotional well-being. And so more on that a little bit later, but this is something that we continue to work on. Are there plans to provide translations in languages, other languages in the future? This is a constant question that we get, and it is one that we always are trying to answer better and better. Because we are a world-recognized organization, we want to strive for nuance and distinction so that every person can see their language and their culture reflected in our assets and in our resources. And so to that end, whenever we build resources in different languages, it needs to be verified and approved by any component of Sesame Street that is using that same language. And it also needs to be funded by groups that can use that language. And so in all of the different ways that we build assets, we always try to look for ways that we can get funding to continue to put it in different languages. That is not the end of the answer, that is the beginning of the answer. So just be patient with us as we continue to try to get this work out to everyone. So a question about what psychologists can do to get involved with Sesame Street. The good thing is you are already part of the Sesame Street family. APA and all of the work you do guides all of the ways we've been able to build assets connected to emotional well-being and their families. As our work continues to grow and develop, there will be further opportunities for us to work with APA in this partnership to build professional development tools and other webcasts like this to both get the learning out there and to crowdsource brilliance from all of you on what other learnings can look like and what requests we can satisfy. The question of is there an app? There's not an app specifically for these resources yet, but Sesame Street has a wealth of apps that children and families can use together. And I will answer one last question if I can find one. Are there any resources for older children? So again, our age range and sweet spot is typically birth to 8 with a focus on 2 to 6. For those older children, what we can typically do is we have some partnerships with other organizations that are connected to Sesame Street, like Ghost Riders, like PBS affiliates that also age up some of our resources, but use them intentionally for older children. And so I would suggest using PBS or PBS affiliates to see what other things can continue to carry on. That's all for me. Thank y'all for being you and for making time for us. Dr. Bufka, thank you for all the guidance you shared with us. Any closing remarks from you before we finish up today?
Oh, it's just been so exciting and sort of uplifting to be part of this. How can you not feel positive and hopeful about what we can do to bring a little love to the world and help people with their big feelings after spending an hour with Sesame? So thank you so much for partnering with us. We love it here at APA and love the way that together we're really making a difference for the younger children in our lives.
Awesome. Well, thank you again, Dr. Bufka. Thank you to the more than 600 people that joined us today for all of your work with children and families working together to build smarter, stronger, kinder communities, one relationship at a time. And with that, I'll pass the microphone over to Efla. Take care, everyone.
Thank you, everybody, for joining us today. Please, round of applause for our amazing presenters, Antonio and Lynn. We want to hear from you, so please fill out our survey at the end of the webinar. And we will also be sending you a follow-up email with links to resources. Thank you for joining us.